Hello everyone. Welcome you all to the next webinar of WSO2 API-320 webinar series. Today in this webinar, we are going to discuss about the nurturing API platform with API analytics. So if you have any question, you can post them on the question tab of the GoToWebinar panel during the session or at the end of the session. At the end of the webinar, we will send the recording and slides to all the registrants. I'm Rukshan Premathunga, Associate Technical Lead in API Magic team. And today, Tanya Madhuraperum is with me, and she's a Technical Lead in API Magic team. Let's check today's agenda. First, we will discuss about what is analytics and why it is important in API management. Then we will discuss about the different parties involved or interested in API analytics. Then we will check a little bit of analytics and API management architecture. Also, we will discuss about the analytics dashboard and its features. And we'll also talk about the reporting capabilities of analytics. Then we will have an analytics scenario along with a demo. And finally, we will have an interactive Q&A session. What is API analytics in API management system? In a typical API management system, there can be multiple nodes in a control plane or in a data plane. So it could be a classic deployment or containerized deployment. In such a system with too many nodes, it is hard to identify or track usage without single analytics system. Thousands of application access systems and thousands of APIs are served in the system. Different types of users access system, including developers and end users. Some of them connect from external systems. Similarly, too many information are going through an API management system. In these entities, following piece of information, we can identify with a proper analytics solution. We can identify the users and its location, either different hops, geolocation, regions, and time zone, etc. Also, specific information about end user's device, its type, running operating system, and type of application, whether it is a web application, desktop application, or a mobile application, sometime application versions such as deployment related information like gateways, DCs, if there are multiple DCs, and regions, also possible to identify. And artifact related information like application, API, and endpoint details also can be extracted directly or indirectly. Let's check what type of analytics is required for API management system. These are the main requirements of analytics solution. If we check each of the requirements one by one, operation analytics is required to monitor the system. Also, it is required to have an alerting mechanism in case if abnormal things occur. Because there are multiple things that can fail in API management system, and you can't just identify all of them by looking at the dashboard. So alert mechanism is required to inform you such the incident in a production setup. Also, you can use monitoring analytics to optimize an API management solution by scaling, caching, or region-wise deployment. Other requirement is business analytics. With business analytics, you will be able to identify the direction of the organization, whether it is aligned with your company goals. Also, you can monitor the business growth by looking at some metrics like usage and monetization related activities like subscription creation. Also, looking at metrics, you will be able to predict and adjust company strategies. Next one is developer analytics. With that, API and application development related information can be extracted. So developers can have an idea about their popularity and performance. Last one is monetization. So this is an important use case. In order to monetize, your APIs need to have exact numbers. So to get that exact numbers, analytics is required, and data should feed to billing engine for monetization. Let's check the analytics stakeholders or parties interested in analytics. Managers or CXO, they are interested in business data from analytics, probably working on historical data and come up with some summarized information. Analyze the current growth and define new goals. Architects, they are interested in architectural aspects of the system. Take architectural decisions based on the analytics data. DevOps engineers, they monitor the system health and abnormal activity, identify the source of the issue and take action or report to the responsible person. API developers, they are interested in API statistics of their API. So they monitor the usage and performance of the API. Similarly, application developers are also interested in analytics related to their application. So they will monitor the usage of the application and application users and fault cases, etc. Let's check about the API analytics architecture. API manager can be deployed as on-premise, cloud, or hybrid. So it is better to have an idea about the architecture if it is on-premise deployment. As you can see in the diagram, analytics run as two JVM. One is for worker and which is responsible summarizing data events, and dashboard is responsible to query data from summarized data sources and represent it on the UI. Dashboard also provides dashboard portal and business rule portals. Business rule portal is also an UI which allow configure custom values in CD applications. Similar to the publisher and dev portal, OIDC SSO is enabled in these two portals. So analytics UI portals also use the same user store as API manager portal. So we have same set of users across the analytics and API manager. So let's check how analytics works in detail. DHA is responsible to serve API requests. When an API request is served, it will generate an event with details of the API request and send it to analytics. There are three main analytics events triggered in following cases. If a request is successfully served in the gateway, which means it is goes to the backend successfully and back to the client, an event with the name org.wso2apmgtstatistics.request sent to the analytics. If a runtime fault is observed during this time, it will send another event with name org.wso2apmgtstatistics.fault. If a request is get throttled out, an event with name org.wso2apmgtstatistics.throttle.sent. Analytics use WSO2 TGS processing engine, and which has capabilities of event aggregation, purging, and multiple event sync and source support. Also, it has capabilities to process data in real time. TGS aggregation are used to summarize data and which support multiple granular level summarization. Hence, API analytics also support per second to per year granular level summarization. These are the analytics information we have with WSO2 API manager. It supports traffic analysis, and with that it provides API invocation statistics so that API invocation of APIs, application devices, device users can be monitored. API error analysis provides response code, runtime errors, and throttle-wise error analysis. Performance analysis also supports with API's latency time. It supports latency breakdown up to the resource level. Also, it summarizes end-user related information and provides usage count of devices, browsers, and geolocations. Finally, it contains developer interest instances. That's related to APIs, application, subscription creation, and user sign-up. So these are the main analytics type API analytics offer. So let's check what are the analytics dashboard and its characteristics. So these are the list of analytics dashboard that is available in APM Analytics, and let's check and discuss each of them one by one. Business analytics dashboard, it is designed to derive business insight of the organization. If we take some examples, you can identify the popular devices and regions. Based on that, you can decide whether to support localization for that region. Also, you can invest more on developing new applications for the popular devices. Promotion or marketing campaign can be initiated in those regions. So based on the numbers, you can decide whether you should invest more on those regions or not. Also, you can define new monetization plans so that you can check usage patterns of the APIs. Also, you can check subscription creation pattern for these APIs. Also, you can check what are the external systems communicate with the APM system. So it could be a different services which provide backend services for your system, or it provide different social media users from different IDPs. So based on that, you can initiate and partnership with those parties. Also, you can identify the business growth. By looking at the API usage, you can identify the growth of API usage and how it would impact the revenue to the organization. Increase of APIs could be improvement or new release of the product team. So in future, it will be another revenue generating API. Increase of application means more application start using this API. Increase of subscription creation means more application try to use this service and could be another direct revenue generating factor. User sign up in more application, developers try to consume APIs and try to implement their own application. So that's why they have sign up in developer portal. If you take characteristic of this dashboard, it supports long-term data. So you can take past data and come up with some decisions. This dashboard supports most of the analytics types APM Analytics support. It includes top summarization data, API and application related analytics, usage, traffic performance, and fault analysis, and also geolocation and devices related analytics also support. The most important thing is it supports drill down, so you can pinpoint to some use case by going through one widget to another. This is usually recommended for admin users, so managers who is responsible for taking business decisions. So that by default, users with admin role or internal analytics role can view this dashboard. As you know, APM portal support access control for APIs, but this dashboard does not honor that and show you analytics related to any applications or APIs without any restrictions, since the target audience is managers. The monitoring dashboard. So this dashboard is focused on operation aspect of the system. It supports following type of metrics. In error analysis, it provides response code-based analysis. With that, you can identify application-related errors. If an API has abnormal 4xx error count, which means there are client-side issues. If we check application-wise errors, we can identify the application with a higher 4xx error rate. So this should be an issue with application, because application user input validation, or it can be a bug in the application. So we can inform application developer and ask him to check their application. Also, if you notice abnormal 5xx error for a particular API, it could be an issue in that API, either with API level validation or bug in the backend APIs, or maybe the bug in the mediation sequence. In such cases, API we can inform API developers and developers and ask them to review their API. Next error type is faulty. A faulty is referred to as consider in a case if a runtime exception occur in an API during the serving time, it could be due to the connection issue with the backend or an exception in the mediation flow. So this needs to be analyzed further with system logs and identify the issue. So then we can report it to responsible parties. With total out error analysis, it provides application and API-wise total out API counts. If those numbers are abnormal, it can be used to review API level subscription policies. This can be compared with successful counts and policies to check allow count is allow quota is enough for this API. Also, we can check application-wide throttling count as well. So then check there are any user or application try to overuse this API. So then we can take necessary action. Similarly, with performance analysis, we can identify many useful information. Here we use the latency time to analyze performance. So let's check what are the information we can extract. This dashboard provides latency breakdown up to the API resource level, which means we can identify the latency time of a resource and get latency breakdown of each stages. In here, stages mean latency time taken for authentication, mediation, throttling, and backend, etc. So we can identify which stage it consumes more latency time. And take action based on the stages. Let's say if the higher latency time is noticed in a mediation or backend layers, then this could be issue with the implementation. So we can inform this to the API developers. Also, we can analyze latencies in a time series graph and identify any specific time this happens. So sometime due to the increase of the load and the response time of the backend APIs get increased. Also, DevOps also can notice network level latency. So in such cases, they can improve latency with hardware optimization and introduce some cache. Also, they can check evolution of the API. If a bug notice in an API, a new version is released. Then these versions can be compared and identify the performance gain. Monitoring dashboard support traffic or user channel analysis of the system too. These are the important uses of them. We can analyze the usage pattern of APIs and identify the spike. It could be due to the abnormal use access or a fraud activity. So could be due to the season or the time. Also, we can analyze the usage pattern and predict required capacity. If we notice API invocation getting increased, then we need to scale the gateway and support the expected capacity. When the invocation increase, backend also should support this capacity. If not, we have to scale that one too. But there are some cases if there are some limit for the backends and APIs, then we have to adjust and maintain that limit by defining and maintaining throttle policies and its limits correctly. Monitoring dashboard is actually recommended to admin managers and DevOps users. So by default, users with admin and internal analytics all allowed to view this dashboard. It is designed to provide short-term data to take action based on the recent data. So by default, time duration is check to last day and last week. In this dashboard also, there is no any restriction to view API or application data. The API analytics dashboard. So API analytics dashboard is designed for API developers to view analytics of their API. So by default, internal creator, internal publisher, and admin users can view this dashboard. This includes some subset of widgets in business analytics dashboard because some use cases are already in the business analytics dashboard too. But in this dashboard, it applies publisher access control for APIs, and it shows analytics of APIs logged in user can see. This dashboard supports long-term data into the business analytics dashboard. API analytics dashboard also supports following type of analytics. Developer can analyze the traffic pattern, and with that, they can identify the popular APIs with usage count and subscription creation. So they can invest more on those APIs and maybe release a few more versions with some improvements. Also, they can identify the APIs, its usage count or the population getting deeply. So those APIs can be deprecated. Also, based on the usage, they can decide what are the subscription plans to import these APIs and update the throttling policies accordingly. Also, performance of APIs can be monitored, and based on the latency time, they can debug further and fix issue if they found an issue. So this could be either in a mediation part or actual backend service. So they can take necessary action based on that. Also, one important thing in here is they can identify most popular API resource of the system. So they can create new products with those resources and provide a new single APIs with most popular resources. Application analytics dashboard is focused on analytics related to their application. So by default, subscribers and admin users can access this dashboard. But in order to view analytics, logged in users should have applications created or shared. So analytics application owners can check the steps of the application by logging into the application analytics dashboard. But even for admin can't see the steps of the other applications. So these are the useful analytics app developers can get. With the usage pattern analysis, they can check on application popularity and decide how to improve or invest on their application. Analyzing API usage, they can predict how much usage capacity they required and use. Based on that, they can use required subscription policy. Also, based on the pattern, they can upgrade or degrade existing subscriptions. Also, with end user analysis, they can identify the application users and type of users that access their application. Based on that, application throttling policy can be defined in order to distribute the allow quota of API equally among the users. Also, they can check fault invocation for the application and identify the APIs that caused this error. Then they can contact API developers or support team to resolve those issues. Next, check about analytics dashboard access control. So as I mentioned earlier, all the API and analytics portals support OIDC SSO. With that, access control support using scope-based authorization. Each dashboard supports three main operations like view, edit, or own dashboard. With view permission, you can access it and check available analytics. With edit permission, you can view the dashboard. And additionally, you will be allowed to design the dashboard. Example, like you can modify the widgets, modify pages, and change the layout. With the owner permission, you will be able to view and edit dashboard. And addition to that, you will be able to change access control of the dashboard. So when configuring dashboard, you can define required scope in order to give required permission for the dashboard. Customized analytics dashboard is another requirement normally organizations have. So dashboard design changes include add remove pages, add remove widgets in a page, or change page layout, and those things. And there are multiple use cases to customize a dashboard view. But there are some restrictions and guidelines to follow when customizing dashboard. Because default dashboards are not allowed to customize, and dashboard name, URLs, and layout, and widgets are not allowed to modify. But it allows you to update the access control permission. If there is any requirement to customize dashboard, let's say to reorder the widgets or add remove widgets, then you can follow these steps. You can duplicate the dashboard and do the required changes from the design view. Or else you can export the dashboard and then do the changes and then redeploy. Then again, you can go to the design UI to customize. So in order to export to duplicate, you should have the editor owner permission. So there are some scenarios to add new charts to dashboard types. So this is done with custom widget, and we'll check how it is working. So sometimes organizations need to do some change to existing widgets, and sometimes they need new widgets with custom charts or something. So in such cases, what we can do is we can take source code of the existing widget and do the modification. Or if you want to start widget creation from scratch, to implement widget from scratch, analytics provide you an tool to generate widget skeletons for you. So widgets are UI components and implement using React. So this tool will create you a project with required structure and parent widgets. So the default widgets are actually used out of the box, supporting charting libraries like WhisCamo or Victory. But with a custom widget, you can include your any third-party libraries as design and working on the implementation. But once a widget implementation done, then you will get the deployable file. So then you can put this file into the mentioned directory and deploy it. So once it is deployed, then it will be listed in the dashboard design page. So then you can just drag and drop it to your dashboard. You can design your dashboard with the new widget. So let's discuss about the next topic, which is analytics reporting capabilities. So first, let's check why the reporting capabilities are required. Also, at the end of this presentation, we will have a demonstration about the available reports we have. So one requirement is monetization and the billing requirement, because some system still needs CSV or PDF to generate invoices. Also, to include details report to an invoice, you need to have a reporting capabilities. We can generate reports and keep it it later for historical data analysis, or can be shared it with others. So people for the people who don't have access to the Antics portal, we can get it and we can share it with them. So as I mentioned earlier, some system still take CSV or text files as input to generate invoice. And such cases, you can get these files and feed it to those systems. Let's check the reporting capabilities in API Analytics have. So report dashboard is there to provide details, report for a particular tenant. With that, you have option to select time and generate a report. So this data is downloaded in a PDF format and its content can be also customizable. And also there are some widgets in the dashboard in tabular format. So those data also can be exported. And these data actually can be exported either in CSV or PDF format. In this widget, you can filter and select the required data and do the export. So then you get the desired data. Also, all the widgets in the analytics dashboard support exporting current view of the widget. So what it actually do is it just simply take a screenshot and then it exports as a PDF. So yeah, so this is the end of the presentation and we will have a prepared demonstration to show you analytics capabilities. So Tanya will continue the demonstration. So Tanya, can you please take over?
Thank you, Rukshan. So I have a WSO2 API manager and an analytics server up and running. I also have created several APIs and published those in the API gateway. And a number of requests have been executed to generate some traffic. So we are ready to go. I am at the login page of the analytics dashboard. And I will be logging into the dashboard with the admin user so that I will be able to see all the dashboards that is available by default. So let's walk through each of these dashboards to see what are the information that we can derive using these dashboards. I will first pick the monitoring dashboard, which is a new addition to the 3.2.0 release. The home page of the monitoring dashboard provides us a holistic view with aggregating different views of APIs. And this also acts as the route of navigation to the subsequent pages via drill downs. The number widgets appearing at the top of the page displays the usage count, fault count, throttled out count, and the highest latency for the last 24 hours. And the small number appearing here denotes the respective counts and respective counts compared to the previous 24 hours and whether it's an increase or a decrease, and their percentages along with that. And the API info summary widget here displays the API invocation counts categorized as 2xx, 4xx, 5xx, faulty and throttled out counts, depending on the limit that we have set here. So let's now look at the possible navigations from the home page. So if we click on this API usage summary widget, that will take us to the traffic page. So in the traffic page, the API usage summary widget that we have, which is a stack chart, displays the aggregated API invocation count for each API for a selected time period. So the selected time period can be altered using the date time picker widget, which is appearing at the top of the page. So all the pages in the monitoring dashboard contains a date time picker widget except for the home page. So we can either select a quick range or we can select any custom range and get the data filtered in the rest of the widgets that is there in the page. So coming back to the API usage summary widget, And so in this API summary widget, a request is considered as success if the request is dispatched from the backend and a response is received. So in case a runtime or a backend connection error occurs, those are considered as faulty. So looking at the proportion of the calls resolved as successful and faulty, we can get an idea whether the whether our backend is working properly or not. We also can filter the results available in this chart, the statistics in this chart up to resource level. So for an example, say I want to see the statistics of the loan API and the version the 350 and maybe for the business resource. So the data will be filtered based on the selected filters. And furthermore, like we also can drill down into this resource level statistics, which will display the overtime API invocation counts by clicking on this bar. So by looking at this API usage overtime widget, we can get an idea of the traffic pattern for that particular resource. So apart from the traffic page, we also have the error page, which will display us the erroneous and which will display us the information about erroneous and faulty APIs. So we can navigate to the error page either by clicking on the left navigation directly, or we can go back to the home page and by clicking on the API default summary widget, API fault summary widget, it will take us to the error page. So in the error page, we have four dedicated pie charts for 4XX, 5XX, faulty and total out counts that represent top APIs and applications along with the error hit percentage out of the total hit counts. So we can toggle between the applications and APIs, and the chart will be reloaded based on the selection. For an example, for this ABC finance applications, there have been 32 4XX errors. And so say that we are interested in seeing what are the APIs that has caused these 32 errors. So we can click on this particular portion of the pie chart, and that will take us to the error summary widget, which will show us the breakdown of the error counts. So this error summary widget has two views, that is the percentage view and the count view. So in the count view, we can see like how those 32 4XX errors have been distributed among different APIs. Furthermore, if we are interested in seeing like which version of this particular APIs has caused this many errors, we can drill down up to the API version level by clicking on the API name. So this particular loan API has two versions, 360 and 350, and then the 17 errors that was there for the 4XX has been distributed among these two as 2 and 15. So if we want to further drill down into the API resource level, that is also possible by clicking on the API version, clicking on the desired API version. So that will show us the available API resources and the respective error counts for those resources. And say that we want to see the distribution of these error counts over time for this particular resource, then we can click on this resource, and then that will take us to the error summary over time widget, where we can see the distribution of different types of errors over time. And then we have the latency page, which helps us to identify the slow APIs in the system and the performance of the APIs and like the reasons behind the slowness. So this API latency summary widget is a stack bar chart which has the latencies of the slowest APIs arranged in the descending order, depending on the limit that is set here. So each of these bar is consisted of different latencies, such as backend latency, security latency, throttling latency, etc., for a single API request. So we can use the interactive legend here and select or deselect different types of latencies here to see a better view of other latencies. For an example, I have disabled the backend latency, request mediation latency, and the response mediation latency to see a finer variation of the security latency and the miscellaneous latencies. So by looking at this graph, we can identify and address what has caused due to the slowness of the APIs and address those. And similar to other pages, we can click on this one of these bars, and then we can drill down into the latency over time widget. So in this widget also, we have this interactive widget. We can switch on and off different latencies and see a better view. Apart from those, we also have this alerts page. And this alert page displays statistics about alerts that is generated in the system. So this API availability summary widget shows the percentage of availability of the APIs that is currently there in the system. So as per this widget, 88%, 89% of APIs are currently available, and 11.111 APIs have encountered a server errors. So if I am interested in seeing what are these APIs that have server errors, I can click on this, and then the API availability widget here will show me the APIs which have a malfunctioning servers. So it is also possible to like filter the available results in this API availability widget using the available filters here. We have the top API by alert count widget. And this widget gives us the information about total aggregated alert count for each API. For an example, this count that is displayed here is a sum of frequent tier limit hitting alerts, abnormal request count alerts, abnormal resource pattern alerts, etc. And then, like, if we want to see the breakdown of this count, we can click on this API, and then that will take us to the alert summary widget. And in the alert summary widget, we can see the alerts generated for that particular API and their severity level, and also time that this particular alert is triggered, and a small description about explaining the reason about the about triggering of this alert. So that is basically about the monitoring dashboard. So let me now demonstrate the reporting capabilities that is available for this data. So let me select all alerts, and let me bit increase the limit here. So all the tabular widgets in the monitoring dashboard has this export button, which makes it possible for us to download the report of this data either in CSV or PDF formats. And when I click on this on the desired format, it will download me a report from that particular format, and that report will contain the data that is generated from this particular widget. So this will have all the information that was there in the alerts widget. And then it is also possible to generate reports out of a custom data set that we want. For an example, say I want to generate a report that will only contain alerts that are triggered for the car rental API, and say I want APIs that has only alerts that only have moderate severity. So I can filter the available results and then generate the report that I want. And then this report will only contain the data about car rental API and the severity moderate. So the generated reports are different based on the filtering that I choose. So going back to the dashboard listing page, so the reports dashboard that is available here provides us the capability to generate a monthly API usage report depending on the month that we select from this particular drop-down. See, I want to generate usage report for the month of October. I can click on download and that will generate me a report which will contain the request counts for each APIs during the month of October. So let's go back to the dashboard listing page. And coming back to the business analytics dashboard. So the business analytics dashboard is targeted for managerial users. And the overview page of the business analytics dashboard has the statistics about API usage, API performance, and throttled out APIs, and falls that has occurred for the top 10 APIs for the past 30 days. And then like by clicking on these, each of these widgets, we can see a maximized view of these widgets with the possibility to select and deselect APIs to do a comparison. Say for an example, I want to compare two APIs, then I can select those APIs from this API selector and compare those. As an example, say we have created a new version of a particular API, and then we want to see the adoption of the new version compared to the previous version. So for that, we can select whatever the APIs that we want from this selector, and then see the statistics according to that selection. So here I have selected the 100 version of the PizzaShack API and the 140 version of the PizzaShack API. And then I can see the adoption of the second API compared to the first API. And here we can see that the usage count for the 100 version has degraded with the time, and like the usage has increased for the new version of the API. So we can use this API selector widget and deduce that type of information from these widgets. So going back to the overview page, so it is similar to the API usage widget. It is also possible to have a maximized view of other three widgets and also compare and contrast API statistics using the API selector widget. So apart from that, we have the usage summary page, which has summarized information of API request counts against different matrices, such as applications, the backend URLs, API resources, and API users. So this page can be used to see statistics of API request counts against different matrices. Apart from that, we also have the devices page that will display information about the request counts made on different API, different platforms, and different user agents. So as Rukshan mentioned during the slide, so we can use these statistics to to develop responsive UIs based on mostly used user agents and platforms, and to derive other information. So we also have this developer statistics page in the business analytics dashboard, which will contain information about statistics about subscriptions, application creators, and also the developer signups. And there are several other pages that are available in the business analytics dashboard, but we will not be going into the details during this demo. We invite you to go through the rest of the pages and to see what are the information that we can derive from these pages. So let me go back to the dashboard listing page. So in the dashboard listing page, we have the API analytics dashboard, which is basically a cut down version of the business analytics dashboard. So the difference in this API analytics dashboard is the listing that is generated here is based on the access control settings that is set in the publisher for each of these APIs for this particular logged in user. So this will only have the APIs that are authorized for this logged in user. And this has a limited set of statistics compared to the business analytics dashboard. So application analytics dashboard is targeted for the application developers. And this dashboard has statistics related to applications, the fault invocations for applications, top application users, and API usage of application, and different other statistics that are summarized around applications that are authorized for the logged in user. So going back, so that is all about the available dashboards. Now let me demonstrate you how we can change the access control of these dashboards. So each of these dashboard has a settings menu that will take us to the dashboard settings page. So in the dashboard settings page, we can see the scopes that are assigned for owners, editors, and viewers. Using this page, we can either remove existing scopes, or we can either add new scopes and then change the available dashboards permissions to each of these dashboards. So that brings us to the end of this demo. So if you have any questions, you can post them in the questions tab. So we have one question asking, is it possible to customize the monthly API usage report? Yes, the default implementation can be overridden and extended by implementing the report generator interface. So you can refer to the default implementation as a reference and write your own custom implementation to customize the monthly API usage report. And there's this other question asking about, does API analytics dashboard provide the ability to white label the dashboards? Yes, the WSO2 logo and the favicon icon, favicon that is available in the analytics dashboards can be changed into your desired logo and favicon. So if you have any further questions, you can.
So there is another question. So the question is, are the same publisher subscriber also used for API manager also to be used for analytics? Or can we control analytics portals access with different roles of publisher subscribers? So the answer is here, yes, we can control access with any other roles, because by default, we only have the default role, so that's why the access control is defined based on those roles. but you can define any custom roles from the management console and apply the those restriction with by define a scope. So for the that question answer is yes. And yeah, so we have another question. So the question is, do you support analytics for GraphQL APIs as well? So yeah, so answer is yes. So it supports analytics for all the API types API manager support. So including GraphQL, WebSocket, and API product. So the answer is yes.
Okay, so if you have any further questions, like you can either post them in the WSET API Manager Slack channel. If you have not already joined the API Manager Slack channel, you can use the link available here and join the Slack channel. We also encourage you to download and try out API Manager and the analytics API Manager analytics server. If you have any questions regarding the features that are supported, you can also create issues in the GitHub repos available here. We also appreciate if you could take spare a few minutes and fill up the questionnaire that has been shared with you to provide the feedback for this demo. That brings us to the end of this demo, and thank you everyone for joining.
Yeah, so actually we have another question. So the question is there a way to view API traffic by geographic region? So answer is yes. We have geographic based analytics, so you can check the API traffic based on the geographic region.
Rukshan, do we have any more questions? So like, are we good to wind up?
Looks we don't have any pending questions. So if there's any questions, so they can send it, so we can reply them, right?
Yes, if there are any more questions, we will try to get back to you via email. And thank you everyone for joining the webinar. Goodbye.
Okay, thanks. Goodbye.